Booth and welcome to my studio. Today I'm going to paint a snow demonstration. I had done a snow demonstration at a local art club and I put the result of that on Facebook and it seemed very popular, so I thought I would use the same subject and do a quick demonstration of how I approach the painting of a snow scene. Now, the original subject is just the plain landscape. It doesn't actually have any snow on it. We don't get a lot of snow in Northern Ireland. So I've just used an ordinary landscape and essentially I've replaced the grass with snow. So let's see how we get on.
Well, we begin by mixing up a grey, and that's cobalt blue, burnt sienna, a little bit of viridian, maybe a little bit too much. Try some more cobalt, some more burnt sienna and a little bit of alizarin. That gives us a better grey. There we go. And the idea is to get this on as quickly and simply as possible. I like to vary the colour quite a lot, and that's what I do just as I continue on. So it gives me, instead of a flat single colour wash, it gives me a nice range of variations. A little bit more cobalt, a bit pure cobalt. I'm going to try the snow now. Remember, the snow isn't white paper. The snow is just lighter than everything else. So a little bit more warmth in the sky, keeping this idea that we need to have warmth in a snow scene. And while that's still wet, I can drop that bit of cadmium red, a little bit of cadmium red in, without having to worry too much. It will blend and move. Leave it alone, and it will let watercolour do its own thing. That's always the best thing. Some more cobalt for the snow. And I want to bring this on down fairly simply. A little bit more warmth in it with the cadmium. Need to get some more warmth into the snow, so I'm using some raw sienna, just dropping that in. I tried a little bit of quinacridone gold beforehand, but it turned green, so the raw sienna is a safer bet. A little bit more of the cobalt and burnt sienna, that gives me the grey, and then a little bit of viridian, again for more greeniness. And this is to strengthen up the sky. The sky now essentially is not much different in tone to the snow, so we need to darken the sky to get that tonal difference more obvious and more apparent. So again, using the cadmium red to introduce some warmth into the sky, and we'll bring that down to the tree line on the most distant hill. Changing over to a smaller synthetic brush. I'm going to use this now. You're going to use the side of this with a strong ultramarine, burnt sienna, a little bit of cadmium, and I'm going to use this to try to get a nice dark ridge of trees on the far hill. And again, that will help me to get the strong contrast between the sky and the snow. Just work on along, using the same mix to give me a hint and an indication of the hedges in between the fields. Remember, the fields are covered in snow, the hedges, the hedges could be covered in snow too. In this case, it's much easier that they're not, because then we can see the hedges. So side of the brush again to give a sort of dragged, semi-dry brush look to it. Remember that the brush isn't made to release paint from the side, so it doesn't do it very well, so you tend to get a nice dragged look to the brush, or to the paint stroke. Same mixture essentially down at the end of the near field, and ignoring all the foreground trees at the moment, they'll come later, and again varying the colour. So we're using that mixture of ultramarine or cobalt along with burnt sienna to give a grey, and then modifying that grey with various things. We can use a little bit of cadmium to warm it up, a little bit of alizarin crimson even, or more of the burnt sienna, or more of the blue to give a slightly warmer or cooler grey, and just work on across the picture to finish that line of distant shrubs. Again, lots of nice variations, so that we get both a colour variation and a tonal variation. Using some smaller strokes of a really strong mixture of ultramarine and burnt sienna, just to hint at the branches. Really no more than that. This is a little sword liner brush that I use for these type of strokes. Back to the synthetic brush again. I'm going to go for some warm tones, some of the raw sienna, mixed up with some of the previous colour that was on there, which was again a nice warm reddy brown. And I'm going to use this for the sort of dry, scrubby type of grass that's in the middle. And the trees, essentially, the main foreground trees are growing out of this little area of dry grass. And again, it gives us that little area of warmth. I'm using three tones. I've already applied the light tone. I'm now applying a medium tone. So essentially, I repeat the same strokes more or less, but do less of them. And then finally, a dark tone, and that will be ultramarine and burnt sienna. And again, I repeat some of the previous strokes, but less again. So I use less strokes each time. Try to cover no more than half of the previous wash with the next wash. Keep adding to the warmth of this section. Some more warmer tones, some warmer colours, the burnt sienna, and that will help the illusion of the depth of the scrubby grass. If it was just done on a flat single tone, that wouldn't really work. Some more cobalt now to hint at the undulating shadows that you get on snow. This time I'm applying them just wet on dry, but what I need to do is to soften the edge, because you don't get sharp edges. The snow covers the ground like a blanket, so therefore you get soft edges. So I'm just squeezing my brush dry, rinsing the brush, squeezing it dry, and the little bit of residual dampness in the brush just allows me to soften the edges of those wet strokes, and that gives me a softening of the edge, which is more believable in the snow. Same thing in the foreground. I'm using some plain water to dampen the top of the snowbank, and then I'm going into the lower edge of that water with again some cobalt, and that the idea is that that gives me a light top and a slightly darker side to the snowbank. Finish that off with a straight line, because there's going to be a little bit of water there, a little puddle of water. Same thing again, touch of plain water and then the cobalt added to give the light top, darker side, but it's a light to dark gradual tonal change. It's not a sudden tonal change. More cobalt. A little bit, just darkening the cobalt slightly. And again, this is just to get some more variations on the snow and trying to get these nice undulating marks to do that, to get this illusion of the sort of blanket shape, if you like, of the snow covering the uneven ground. And the same idea, we have the softening between the lighter top to the top of the banks and the darker side, but a soft transition between the two. Now, going for some really strong darks, ultramarine burnt sienna, I'm going to use these for the trees. We're just going straight in with this dark tone, not varying it in any way. That will come later. So I'm just trying to get a feel for the tree and a feel for the shape of the tree, and just continue these strokes, getting a rough structure for the group of trees that are growing out of that little foreground grassy area. When I've decided I have enough branches, I'll rinse my brush, dry it, squeeze the brush between my finger and thumb, and now I'm going to do some lifting out. I'm going to lift out some of that dark wash that I've just put on. Now, because it's still slightly damp, it will lift off very, very easily, and more importantly, it will give me a soft blend between the light and dark sides of the trunk. So again, because the trunk is cylindrical, you would not get a sudden light to dark change. It would be a gradual light to dark change, and using using a brush to lift out will automatically give me that soft change. I can indicate where branches are crossing over other branches just by lifting a little bit of light out. And I can also do the same thing by adding a little bit of extra dark. So if I have a light branch becoming a darker branch, this all works okay. The idea is just to get variation, interest and variation. Trying to get enough to make it interesting, but not so much that it makes it too busy. Now reverting to the synthetic brush again, I'm looking for a warm dark. So that's, I'm using brown matter there actually, brown matter, ultramarine, a little bit of burnt sienna, just really to get a good rich dark. And I'm going to use this for a few fence posts. Again, just to add interest to the scene. And I'll do those in exactly the same way as I did the trees. So the fence posts are cylindrical and I'll apply the dark paint first. And then when I've got the number of fence posts on that I want, I'll then lift off a little bit of light at the left hand side. Back to the sword liner, and with some more of the same dark mix, I'll use this to just indicate some wire between the posts. And I just use the very tip of the brush, just let it glance along the paper and no more. I'm not using a small size 6 sable brush. And with this I'm going to start indicating the water. Now the water has to be either lighter or darker than its surroundings, or you simply won't see it. It won't be visible as water. So the surroundings are very light because it's snow. So I'm going to make sure that the water is essentially all quite dark. So I'm going to use, I'm going to try reflecting the fence posts and the trees that are directly above the water, and then when this is finished I'll add a little wash to darken the light in between, because if I didn't do that, again the light on the snow would clash with the light in the water, and I don't want that. I want the water to be different. Now while the darker marks in the water are drying, I want to add some warmth to the lighter parts of the tree. So I'm using some warm quinacridone gold mixed with a little bit of the mix that was there before. So it's basically burnt sienna. And I'm just using that to warm up that left hand side of the tree where the evening light would be hitting it. And in winter, the sun's always low, so therefore the light is always warmer than it would be in summer. It'd be much colder in summer. And just varying that colour, just using the raw sienna, quinacridone gold, a little bit of burnt sienna, and that gives me the warmth that I want. Again, using the side of the brush with a synthetic brush and a very dry mix, I'm just indicating a few little stalks of grass peeping through the snow. And again, I'll do this with three tones. So the light tone, and then a medium tone. Exactly the same, really, as what I did with the bank of grass slightly further behind the water. And then a final darker tone. And the three tones give interest They help to give depth, and they help to give substance to the area of the painting. Some cobalt and cadmium red. And that's really the mix I used for the sky, and I'm just lightly painting over the water just to separate that completely from the snow. And now it should read quite well as a little pond or a little river. Now some ultramarine and brown matter, and I'll use a little bit of cobalt as well just to cool this down. I'm going to use this as my shadow wash for the snow. Shadows on snow are really nice because you can indicate the shape of the snow. So by dropping the shadow down the bank of the little bank of snow beside the water, it suggests the drift down. Now obviously there would be no shadows being cast on the water, but they would reappear at the other side. And again, I can use the undulating up and down marks to give a hint of that smooth blanketing shape of the snow. Trying to do all this, essentially you have to be fairly quick with this because you don't get shadows on shadows, so the shadow must be one single continuous wash. So it's important not to let it dry, and you need to make sure that you can mix up quite quickly. Now back to some warmth again with the raw sienna. And I'm just going to use this just to warm up the very foreground area of the snow. Remember, once again, very important, the snow looks white. I mean, it reads as snow, but it isn't white. There's really no white paper there at all. But so long as the snow is lighter than anything that's adjacent to it, anything that's beside it, then it will read as snow. I will just finish off perhaps with a little figure in the distance. Start with the body, because it's easier to judge the size of the figure's head if the body is done first. That's because the head's smaller than the body. If you get the head wrong size, it changes the size of the body dramatically. So a little bit of cadmium red for a coat top. A little touch of dark, just hinting at the legs struggling through the snow. And then just a little dot for the head. Remember, the head is roughly 1/8 or 1/9 the size of the body, there or thereabouts, for an adult. Just maybe bring an arm out in front. Body's leaning slightly forward, so perhaps you'd better support it with a stick. Nobody's going to go out in snow like that without some sort of stick to help them. Then we'll just drop the little stick down above and below where the hand would be. Figure is done very simply. It's a figure in the landscape. It isn't a figure study or anything like that. It's just meant to be a simple figure. And again, a little undulating shadow coming from the back of the figure. Just helps to give the direction of the snow. Now, because I've used cadmium red in the figure, I don't want that to be the only splash of red. So I'm just dotting a few dots of cadmium red around in other parts. That's just to spread the colour around a little bit. Some ultramarine just to darken the shadow side of the figure. Again, just because that will give the figure a little bit more substance, a little bit more three-dimensional shape. And finally, with the figure, another little shadow coming from the pole.
Well, I hope you enjoyed the demonstration. Please visit my website, www.grahambooth.com. On the website, there are more demonstrations, there's a gallery of paintings, there's various other little bits and pieces that you might be interested in. And I'll see you again sometime soon. Bye.